So I'm very excited to finally introduce you to the one and only Matthew Beyranevand, aka Math with Matthew, and his talented co-creators.
Thank you very much, Janice. Thank you for coming here today. For those who don't know, I am the math and science coordinator for the Chelmsford Public Schools. And we're going to be doing a combination of some math activities and some math songs. The draw is the math songs. You're going to be forced to sit through the math activities. But the math that we're going to do is not traditional, boring math. We're going to try and do it in a fun, innovative way because math is really joyful. We talk about STEM and STEAM, and with science and technology and engineering, students, parents, kids authentically like learning about those things. Math, not so much. And so my professional mission is to help change that with educators so that they can learn math in a fun and innovative manner. So before we begin going through some of the math and some of the songs, we have to begin by doing the International Math Salute, which you should be all aware of. Is that correct? No? All right, on your feet. So this is the International Math Salute that's made famous by Dr. James Tanton that all good mathematicians know. So put your hands out straight. Put your right hand over your left hand. Put your hands together. Wiggle your pinky. Wiggle your thumb. Wiggle your pinky. And then come back over. Huh. Let's try it again. Let's try it again. One more time here. OK, hands out straight. Right hand over the left hand. Put your hands together. Wiggle your pinky. Wiggle your thumb. Wiggle your pinky. And come back over. All right, we have some work to do. You can sit down now. It is clear we need to do a little bit of work with our mathematics. So, oh, thank you. So let's start by taking a look at one of the most famous mathematical patterns that we know. Rhombus, would you mind handing those out? And that is Pascal's triangle. This mathematical pattern is something that can be explored in a fun, hand those out to people, in a fun and innovative manner. And what we're going to do is we're going to take a few minutes together today to look at this particular pattern of Pascal's triangle and take a look to find out what are all the things that we can see and understand about this pattern and what things can we observe and draw from it. So the first thing I'd like you to do is take 1 to 2 minutes, talk with someone next to you, and see if you can work together to figure out what is the next row in the pattern, okay? So look together, talk with someone, see if you can determine the next row in the pattern. All right, is there a volunteer? And there's gonna be a lot of volunteering opportunities. Is there a volunteer who would feel comfortable to share for me what they believe would be the next row in this pattern? Yes, Emily. You can come up, absolutely. So you could write, you could write it in.
Okay. I'm going to follow the pattern of the ones.
All right.
Keep those on the side. And then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm going to go with 7 here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I'm going to go 7 here. I see like 6 and 4, 10. 10 and 5, 15. So 6 and 15. I'm going to go 21. And it seems to reflect. So I'm going to go 21 there too. 20 and 15 is 35. And then 35.
Excellent. Nice job, Emily. I am not sure if Emily is an educator or not, but that was excellent teaching. So, in addition to correctly coming up with the next row, Emily also came up with a few important characteristics, patterns involving this. She was able to identify not just the ones here, which is relatively basic. She was also to identify that this next column here is the counting numbers. and there's more to be found there. She also talked about how there's a reflection and that there's a line of symmetry. And one other thing she talked about was, how do you find the next number? And she found that it was the sum of the two numbers directly above it. 6 and 4 make 10, 10 and 10 make 20, 20 and 15 make 35. What I would like you to do is, back with your partners, pairs, take another 1 to 2 minutes and see if you can find anything else as a pattern in this triangle. And if you can't, you could also try to work on what the next row would be, and then we'll hear if there's anything else you can observe from this pattern of Pascal's triangle, and I will share a few things with you as well. So take a look, 1 minute. Okay, any volunteers who would either like to just orally share or come up and identify anything interesting related to this pattern of Pascal's triangle? So what I'm modeling right now is something within teacher talk of wait time. If you wait long enough, eventually someone will volunteer. Yes, Uncle Bobby? Not since I got your name correct.
I don't know how to explain it, but I'll show you. So if we look on a diagonal, difference between 1 and 3 is 2, 6 and 3 is 3, 4, 5, 6.
Okay, very good. So there's a certain pattern here. So the difference increases by 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And there's actually a special name for this group of numbers. They are called triangular numbers, where it makes 1 and then 3 and then 6 and then 10 and 15 and so on. These are triangular numbers. Very good. Thank you. What else? What else can we observe in this? Anything else? Sachi?
If you see like the numbers that make a triangle, they add up to just, so 1 and 1 is 2, 1 and 2 is 3. 2 and 1 is 3, 4 and 6 is 10, 5 and 10 is 15. And
okay, very good. So to find out this number here, how is it created? The sum of the two directly above it, that's diagonal. Excellent, very good. Couple other interesting, oh yes.
For example, 1 doubles to 2, 2 to 4.
All right, let's take a look at that. So the sum of the rows here. The sum of this is 1, the sum of this is 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, and what actually is occurring here, if we talk about exponents, this is 2 to the power of 0, 2 to the power of 1, 2 to the power of 2, 2 to the power of 3, 2 to the power of 4. So if this is row 0, row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4, row 5, it's 2 to the power of whatever that row is. Excellent. Anything else? One other thing that might be interesting to note here, does anybody know about Fibonacci sequence? Anybody feel like they could just tell me the numbers that make up Fibonacci sequence? Anybody know those numbers? All right, go ahead.
3, 5, 7.
Very good. Those are odd numbers, which is good. That doesn't necessarily make up Fibonacci. Fibonacci is a sequence of numbers. The Fibonacci numbers are 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21. The Fibonacci numbers, you add the two previous to get the number. And it's a very famous set of numbers that you can see within nature. Well, if we look here, 1, 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, and 1, 5, 1, 4, 3, 8, 1, 5, 6, 1, 13, the diagonals of Pascal's triangle lead you to Fibonacci. So, what I want you to gain from this here is that when we learn mathematics in the classroom, at home, wherever we do it, it is not meant to be just rote memorization, drill and kill, try to memorize something for the next test, but to be able to be given an exploratory idea, pattern, topic, and give everybody the opportunity to just learn it, spend some time, maybe a little bit more time than we just spend here, to just observe the pattern, extend the pattern, and try to make sense of it. Because this is actually something I find to be beautiful, and many people could find to be beautiful also if they just take the time to enjoy it and not so much focused on taking the same mathematical problem and solving it the same way 20 times, and then you do it another 20 times for homework. What are we really doing? So just something to think about for educators as well as parents. So thank you for indulging me in Pascal's triangle. As I mentioned in the beginning, I am both the math coordinator for the district and the science coordinator. And the inventor of Pascal's triangle, Blaise Pascal from France, was both a mathematician and a scientist. So I have been always torn about what's my true love and my focus. Is it the math? Or is it the science? So the first song that we're going to perform for you today is a song about science and math. So I would like to introduce two people up here today. The first is Chelmsford High School math teacher Dan Williams, who we know as Rhombus. And seventh grade student from Parker Middle School, Sachi Badola. We call her Sachi. Now, Rhombus is here to represent those people that love the math. Who are those people? Sachi is here to represent the science. Who loves the science? And that's what we're trying to fix. More love for the science than the math. So, this is Science and Math War, a song made famous originally as Bad Blood by Taylor Swift. We kept the music and we call it Science and Math War.
It's a science and math war. Time to settle the score. So tell me, who do you fight for? It's a science and math war.
Science is a question, math is barely mentioned. We can take it to another dimension. They say math is better, you all better can it.
It's math that started the game, the language of the universe. Remember the name. Babylonians, Egyptians, Indians, and Greeks came up with the language for all y'all science geeks.
Evolution, distribution, pick your side. It's a science and math war. Time to settle the score. So tell me, who do you fight for? It's a science and math war. Homework problems, and we don't know how to solve them. Time to solve the equation. Academic invasion.
iPad, iPhone, Android, and PC. Without mathematics, none of these could be. Every tweet, every snap, and every single vine. Mathematics is the language upon which you rely.
Mathematics! What you talking about? That's computer science, without a doubt. You might be the language, but you need us to speak it. Think about that before you tweet it. Evolution, distribution, pick your side. It's a science and math war. Time to settle the score. So tell me, who do you fight for? It's a science and math war. Homework problems, and we don't know how to solve them. Time to solve the equation. Academic invasion.
You can't pick math, you can't pick science. Why don't we just form an alliance? If we could all just get along, together we'll be strong. Together we'll be strong. Together we'll be strong. Together we'll be strong. Together we'll be strong.
Rhombus and Sachi! All right, so I want to take this
opportunity now to share with you some resources that I think would be very helpful for you as an educator, as a parent, and as a student to help you better understand math and appreciate math, because math can be very joyful and it can be something that you can really make as a positive impact in your life and in your school.
And I want to take a couple minutes and share with you my thoughts on these here, and then we'll get to our next song. So the first thing is something that I work as a supporter for, as a volunteer, and that's the With Math I Can campaign. And that's done through Amazon Education. And the With Math I Can campaign is looking to get over 1 million people, students, teachers, and parents, to pledge that they will stop saying, I hate math, I can't do math. Because as a parent or a teacher, if you say those words, I hate math, I can't do math, then your students or your children will hear that and they'll say, if my teacher or my father or my uncle or my mother can't do math, how am I going to be able to do it? So the pledge, the hope, is that you will change your mindset and have a growth mindset as opposed to a fixed mindset. And that's the With Math I Can campaign. The second campaign on here is the Global Math Project. And the Global Math Project is something where we are trying to get 1 million teachers, students, and parents to be involved in a special week in October of 2017, where we try to take away all bad curriculum, all unjoyful mathematics, and try to do math in a joyful, meaningful manner. And it's going to be done through something that's called Exploding Dots, which you might not know about it now, but you will know about it next October when it takes over the world. And we're looking for people to be supporters of the Global Math Project as a classroom teacher, as a parent, or as a student. And you can sign up online. And a lot of volunteering that I do is as an ambassador for the Global Math Project. The third resource is a sad self-promotion, and that it is Math with Matthew. And that is my website that fits in not just the math music videos that we're doing here today, but also has a video blog for parents in the community about important issues within math education. There's a podcast on there that talks also about important issues in math education with different teachers. Ms. Swanson has done a podcast episode. Rhombus has done a podcast episode, and it's a way for you to hear from educators about what are important topics to learn more about. And also, there is a pilot TV show on there and a written blog that I do. And the final resource is something that Barnes & Noble is sponsoring here today, and that's a variety of books on math education or appropriate books for children to read that share math in a positive light. And those four books are on the back counter where Janice is today, and they are all on discount for today. It is Mathematical Mindsets by Stanford professor Dr. Joe Bowler, Multiplying Menace, Math Potatoes, and A Mind for Numbers. These are all books that I have read and I have used both as a teacher, as a professor or adjunct professor at higher ed, and with my own kids as well. And then there's one other book on this list, which is a book that's not available today because it's coming out next year, and that's my book, Teach Math Like This, Not Like That. 1 year from today, we'll be back at Barnes & Noble with that book for you. So those are some resources that I would encourage you to use and share as an educator and as a parent. And the most important thing, I believe, out of this whole list has to do with growth mindset. Growth mindset is something that's very important to me as a teacher, where I want my students to come in and believe that if they work hard, they'll be able to understand math. If they make mistakes, it's okay. They will be able to do math, and it's not a problem. If they believe, they come in and say, I can't do math, they will not be able to do math. And it's a job of teachers as well as parents to promote that idea of growth mindset. And this next song we're going to be doing is on growth mindset in mathematics. The name of the song is Teach Me Like You Do, and it's going to be featuring again seventh grade Parker student Sachi.
Thank you.
day I learn math. It's just memorizing facts. It's all road about rules and just so gosh darn procedural. Never knew that it could mean so much, so much. There's a fear I may fail, and I've never been so stressed. I feel dumb, I feel stuck. This is not the way for me to learn. I just see how it makes me afraid, afraid. Teach me like you do, teach me like you do. Don't just show me 2 plus 2, don't just show me 2 plus 2. See beyond the rules, help me see beyond the rules. What are you waiting for? There's a way, it's so great, and it's called growth mindset. Let's embrace our mistakes as a way we can truly learn. 'Cause that's how all our brains can grow, can grow. I'll take a slower pace, 'cause then I'm thinking straight. My head focusing now when I see clearly how. What are you waiting for? Show me 2 plus 2, don't just show me 2 plus 2. See beyond the rules, help me see beyond the rules. What are you waiting for? Come on, sing along.
Teach me like you do, teach me like you do.
Songs under the title of Math with Matthew are not songs that necessarily I just do. It's a collaboration done with Rhombus, with a high school math teacher, Zach McIntyre, who's not here, as well as some of the students who are involved as well. People are behind the scenes. It's a real great collaborative effort of what we're doing to create these songs and the corresponding videos that you can find on MathWithMatthew.com, and you can watch these videos. And it's all about just changing the mindset about learning math. Now, let's get back to the math a little bit. So, in addition to changing mindset, we have to change a little bit of the way that we teach and we learn the mathematics. And the philosophy that I have in regards to math education is very similar to the legend of problem solving, one of the most famous mathematicians related to problem solving, Professor Poya, who talks about how it's better to take one problem and solve it 5 different ways as opposed to taking 5 problems and solving it over and over again the same method. It builds conceptual understanding when you solve it multiple ways, and it really is the definition of number sense, understanding numbers. So what we are going to do is we are going to take a rather basic mathematical problem, and we are going to see, as a group here, how many ways we are able to solve this very basic problem of 25 times 19. Our short-term goal is to come up with at least 5 ways that we can share. Although, if we really push ourselves and we use some of the math educators in the room, we might even come up with 7 or 8 different ways. So what I'm going to do is you're getting a piece of graph paper. You should have pencils. And I want you to see how many ways you can solve this problem. And also, if you have any interesting ways, I'm going to give you also, once you've done a few minutes on the graph paper, give you some chart paper and ask you to record it out. And then we'll share all the different ways in which we can understand how you would solve 25 times 19. Okay? So a couple minutes on your own. So let's talk about some of the different ways that people within our little group solve to come up with the answer of 25 times 19. So we have the traditional way here, where we're multiplying in a sense. Oh, I believe this is done as 9 times 25 is 225, 10 times 25 is 250, and we get 475. Another approach said, okay, I'm going to estimate, round it up to 20, and do 25 times 20, but then it's not 20, it's 19. So I'm going to subtract one group of 25, which is 25, and I do 500 minus 25, which is 475. Another approach took the same idea of 25 times 19, broke it up. So 25 times 10, and then instead of doing 25 times 9, similar to what we saw in the last one, 25 times 10 again, and subtract 25. So we know this is 250, this is 250, which makes 500, subtract 25. We have another creative manner here. This is the lattice approach, which is in a few different curriculum. The lattice approach is kind of the approach of multiplication, but it's done in diagonals instead of straight down, and it kind of avoids the idea of carrying numbers. We don't have this idea of what am I carrying, what am I borrowing, doesn't necessarily make sense. This approach here is not something we can easily share in 30 seconds or so, but this idea of the lattice method is done in some curriculums. It's the way this gentleman knows how to do the math. I'm not gonna say, I don't understand it, I don't want you to do it that way. It makes sense to him. He has the correct answer, so I'm okay with that. And all of us as parents, sometimes we see this common core math and we're scared, what are my kids doing? I can't do this third grade math. It's okay. If they understand it and they can do it, no problem. We need to encourage that and make sure we can learn it a little bit ourselves. Let's look at one more approach here. 25 times 19. So 25 times 19, they broke up the 19 to be 10 and 9, and then we broke up 25 to be 5 times 5, distribute the 5, distributive property, and we get 50 and 45, and then we distribute a second time. 5 times 50 is 250, 5 times 45 is 225. That is not a way that I've ever seen before. I had no idea this was coming, but as a teacher, you need to be able to recognize it, understand it, and appreciate it. This is not something that I would do, but that's okay. It's something that a student would do. It got the correct answer. It makes sense to him or her, and that's okay. For many years, going back to the Egyptians, the Babylonians, the Greeks, everybody has been doing math. We have to find a way to do math that makes sense to them. And speaking of the Greeks, one of the most famous mathematicians from the Greeks is Pythagoras. And I would like to share a little story involving Pythagoras, and then Pythagoras himself is going to be joining us for a song. So the story about Pythagoras is that he was a famous Greek mathematician, and he's most known for the Pythagorean theorem. That's what we know. He also, his name is attached to the discovery of irrational numbers. And the story goes that he has a select cult that follows him and does the mathematics. And they have certain rules they have to follow. And one of the rules is you cannot share the ideas outside of the Pythagoreans. Well, this one mathematician, Hippasus, found out that there was actually irrational numbers, like the square root of 2. And he went to Pythagoras and said, Pythagoras, look, I found an irrational number. And Pythagoras says, no. That does not exist. We do not believe in that. We only believe in ratios or rational numbers. No, Pythagoras, really, this exists. Square root of 2. It's irrational. No. That's the end of it. So Hippasus was concerned. What am I going to do? I have this great mathematical discovery. My leader here won't listen to me. So he went outside of the Pythagoreans, and he shared his work and said, look, there's irrational numbers. And Pythagoras found out. And so he took out Hippasus out in a little boat ride and threw him overboard, never to return. And then after some time, Pythagoras was thinking about it and said, you know what? Son of a gun, that's correct. There are irrational numbers. And then he took credit for it, and now irrational numbers are known as something discovered by Pythagoras. So, we don't want to model that per se, but this is a nice way to introduce our next song, Pythagoras, featuring rhombus and the work of the Pythagorean theorem. Let's hear it again for rhombus.
Pythagoras. Pythagoras. Find the corner that's 90 degrees, cause a right triangle has one of these.
Step two.
Take an adjacent side, multiply it by itself, and set it aside.
Step three.
Do it again, with the other leg, square it and bend. Add a squared to b squared, now what have you got? The square of the hypotenuse, that's what I thought. Take the square of c squared with all of your strength. Now you got c, the hypotenuse length. Yeah, Barnes and Noble, I think we got it. Pythagorean theorem, solving for a, solving for b, and solving for c. Pythagoras. It takes the secrets out of triangles, small or big. A squared plus B squared equals C squared, you dig? Pythagoras had his theorem nailed down tight. For solving right triangles, it's out of sight. If you got a right triangle, you wanna school. Study Pythagoras and follow his rule. Oh no! The end of the song's nearing. That ends the Pythagorean theorem. Pythagoras.
In addition to being a talented singer and rapper, rhombus is also one of the best teachers we have at Chelmsford High School. People are lucky to have him. Okay, as we move into our final math activity, I am interested in sharing with you something that you may not already know, and that is that 2 actually equals 1. And what we are going to do is use a little bit of geometry to prove it here for you today. And I'm going to go through this with you, and then it's going to be your challenge after to see if we can find out what I did. And then we'll have a little bit of a discussion on it. So we're going to start by going through and talking about this particular proof that I'm going to share with you that has 1 equaling 0. So, thank you. We start with a given that B equals A. This is a given here. You're just going to have to, in a sense, believe that's the case. Now, on the first step, what I'm doing here is I'm multiplying both sides of this equation by A. If I multiply both sides by A, I get A times B equals A squared. Next, what I'm doing is I'm subtracting both sides by B squared. I'm going to continually do the same operation of both sides so it stays equal. So I'm not doing anything wrong mathematically. I subtract B squared from both sides. After I subtract both sides by B squared, I'm going to do a little bit of factoring. The factoring that I do on the left-hand side is I'm factoring out a b. So I have b multiplied by a minus b. And on the other side, I'm doing factoring again. A plus b times a minus b. This is mathematically accurate. I will tell you this is mathematically accurate. There's no trick here. When you factor a squared minus b squared, it's a plus b times a minus b. Then I'm dividing both sides here by a minus b. And what I'm left with is just b on the left-hand side and a plus b on the right-hand side. The next step in my proof is that I'm substituting b for a. It's b equals a plus b, and I'm substituting b. The reason I'm allowed to substitute b is because in the beginning I told you as a given that b equals a. So substituting for a, I have b. So b equals b plus b. and B equals 2B, combining like terms. And then if I divide both sides by B, anything divided by itself is 1. B divided by B leaves us with 2. So in fact, 1 equals 2. How's that for mathematics? Pretty good? You have 2 minutes. Talk to a friend, partner, someone near you, and see if you can find out what I did incorrectly to make 2 equaling 1. Talk with each other. Any volunteers who can identify what was done to make 2 equal 1? Yes, sir?
You divide by 0.
What do you mean I divide by 0? There's no 0. It's A's and B's.
A minus B equals 0.
A minus B equals 0, right here? Very good. So let's talk about this for a second. We know these two are equal to each other. So if you subtract them by each other, you get 0. And so what I did here is I divided both sides of the equation by 0, which we cannot do mathematically. Up until here, everything is correct. When you divide by 0, this is where everything begins in error. And I want to take a couple minutes and talk about this particular example. What we do oftentimes in school is we tell students, you can't divide by 0, it's undefined. They often don't ask why, and we often don't tell them why. We want to build conceptual understanding with our students. Not so they could just memorize their multiplication tables, but so they know why they're doing the math that they are doing. So let's take 2 minutes and talk about why we can't divide by 0, and then we are going to finish up with our final song of our show here. Let's start by making sure we understand the definition of division. Division is repeated subtraction. So if I have 12 divided by 3, I'm asking myself, how many times do I subtract 3 from 12 until I get 0? So 12 minus 3, one time, and I get 9. Minus 3 again, I did it twice. Minus 3, I did it 3 times. Minus 3 again, I did it 4 times, and now I have 0. I subtracted 3 from 12 4 times. That's the definition of division. Now, if I do 12 divided by 0, I start with 12, and I subtract 0. And what do I have? 12. Well, let's subtract 0 again. What do I have? 12. One more time. I subtract 0. What do I have? 12. It goes on forever. I will never be able to subtract a number that will get me down to 0. You can't divide by 0. Another example of this is understanding division and multiplication as inverses. Looking at that last example, we know that 12 divided by 3 is 4. So another way we can say it for multiplication is 4 times 3 is 12. If 12 divided by 3 is 4, 4 times 3 is 12. Another example, 30 divided by 5 is 6, so therefore 5 times 6 is 30. Makes sense. So 12 divided by 0, well, what would that be? Following the same pattern, 3 times 4 is 12, 5 times 6 is 30. 0 times what would give me 12? Well, nothing times 0 could give me 12. So there's no way to come up with a value that can be multiplied by 0 to get 12. So therefore, 12 divided by 0 will not give you a value. And there's actually a few additional ways to understand this that I'm not necessarily going to go through. I more want to make the point that when we are teaching our children, both as parents and as educators, that we tell them the why. Make them understand it. You don't necessarily want your student to memorize negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. Well, what did I just say? Am I a robot? Am I a machine? I have no idea necessarily what it is I just said, but I could regurgitate it to you. Okay, quadratic formula. I can regurgitate it to you. What does it actually mean? So take time to make sure that all of our kids understand what they're doing. It makes them appreciate math more, it makes them understand it more, and it's more likely that they will recall it in the future. Okay? So, this is something that's important to me as a teacher. And it's also something that's important to me as a parent, because oftentimes our kids go into math, science, engineering, technology, who are mainly boys. And I have two sons, and I'm very proud that they have that opportunity. But many times, the girls don't have that same opportunity. And so we need to make sure that as parents and as educators, we have our girls given as many of the same opportunities, if not more opportunities, to go into the STEM field. Because when I look at my own data, girls perform just as well, if not better, on state standardized tests than the boys. So we have to change that mindset. And so for our final song that we're going to do today, we're going to take the song of Megan Trainor, who is a very good advocate for girls, and her song that she did, All About the Bass. And we're going to do a song about girls and all about the math. But before we do that, I have to just recognize someone who helped write the lyrics for the song, Girls Are All About the Math, and that is my daughter, Emily, 8 years old. Stand up, Emily. Emily was the one who came up with the chorus for the song, Girls Are All About the Math, and she's someone who loves math and STEM, and I want to make sure that in addition to Emily, but all girls have the opportunity to be successful in the STEM field. So, up one more time, please give it up for Sachi, and also we are inviting up Lyla, seventh grade student from Parker, doing the song, Girls Are All About That Math.
Because girls know all about that math, about that math.
They're really good.
They're all about that math, about that math.
They're really good.
They're all about that math, about that math.
They're really good.
They're all about that math, about that math.
Yeah, it's pretty clear what people say. Girls can do it, in an easy way. But they got that STEM brain that all the kids want, and they're good at school and feel like a savant.
Thank you so much to Sachi, to Lyla, to Rhombus, to Janice for organizing this at Barnes & Noble, to James for taping it, and for everyone for coming. It was a great time. Thank you so much.